Vamos a seguir. Les voy a recordar que esta sesión será en inglés. That said, I would like to present you briefly Professor Bridget Anderson. Bridget Anderson is a professor of migration and citizenship and research director at the University of Oxford Centre on Migration Policy and Society. She has a degree in sociology and previous training in philosophy and modern languages. She is the author of Us and Them, The Dangerous Politics of Immigration Controls, and Doing the Dirty Work, The Global Politics of Domestic Labor. She co-edited Who Needs Migrant Workers, Labor Shortages, Immigration and Public Policy with Martin Bruce, The Social, Political and Historical Contours of Deportation with Matthew Gibney and Emanuela Paoletti, and Migration and Fair Labor, Theory, Policy and Politics with Isabel Schutz. She has explored the tension between labor market flexibilities and citizenship rights and pioneered an understanding of the functions of migration in key labor market sectors. She has worked closely with migrant organizations, trade unions, and legal practitioners at local, national, and international level. Today, her presentation is titled Better Off With Us, Reflections on the Challenges and Achievements of 30 Years of Migrant Domestic Workers Organizing. Whenever you're ready,
Bridget,
thank you very much for being here.
Gracias. Y lo siento, hablaré en inglés, aunque estoy en España. Sorry. So in July this year, in London, we're going to be celebrating 30 years of migrant domestic worker organizing. So I want to reflect on this and talk about some of the questions and issues this raises for our ideas around gender, oppression, and human rights. So I'm going to be talking very much about this particular case, but I believe that it raises much bigger, more general questions. So to start off, in 1987, I used to work with an organization that was, or with a group that was organising Filipino migrant workers in London. And we began to see migrant domestic workers coming to the office, often with very difficult and terrible stories of abuse. They started off coming Filipinos, but then there were Nigerians and Indians and Sri Lankans, and all had entered Britain as migrant domestic workers accompanying wealthy employers. And they all had a visa which had employment prohibited on their on the visa, but often also with the name of the employer written on it. So what that meant in practice was that those, like the women we were meeting who were leaving their employer, were being made undocumented because they were working and they had left the person whose name was written in their employer. The women often described themselves as escaping, such was the violence and abuse that they had experienced, and yet their visa was effectively illegalizing them. So in those days, I was very naive and thought, along with the other people working in the organization, that if we brought this to the attention of the authorities, then they would do something about this visa regime and give migrant domestic workers the right to change employer. But in practice, the government claimed that if they gave them this right, this would mean that rich people wouldn't want to come to England anymore because they wouldn't be able to bring with them their domestic servants. So we decided that we were going to organise a campaign. The workers were emboldened by meeting each other and by coming out as undocumented. And so a self-organised group of domestic workers began to form, called Waling Waling, and a support group called Kaleya Ann, and together we began to campaign for a change in the immigration rules. Domestic workers, especially when they're undocumented, are supposed to be very difficult to organise, but by the time this first phase of the campaign ended in 1998, which was when we won the right for domestic workers to change employers, we had some extraordinary meetings with literally hundreds of undocumented domestic workers in attendance. So 1998, the incoming Labour government regularised most of those who had come to the UK and been made undocumented because of the previous system. And they also introduced a visa that made their immigration status independent of their employer and gave them the right to work and to change employer in case of abuse. However, this hard-won right to change employer was removed in April 2012. The Conservative government had come in with a policy that it was going to dramatically reduce the numbers of migrants coming to the UK for 12 months or more. And migrant domestic workers are now given a six-month non-renewable visa, and they're not allowed to change an employers. So currently, this is the kind of situation we're in. So this is an interview that I did with a woman just a couple of weeks ago. She's currently undocumented. She says, in August 2013, the family came to London again, and the son was travelling with them. He was always harassing me sexually, and when I complained to his mother, she got very angry. They were cruel to all of us. One time he slammed the car door on my fingers when I answered him back. When I couldn't take any more of this, I ran away. I went to Paddington Station and stayed there for 3 months. I used to walk around, and a guy who worked there showed me a place I could sleep. People would give me small money or some food, and that's how I survived. So this is her situation now. She's very worried, she's undocumented, nobody wants to employ her without proper papers. So while we will be celebrating 30 years of domestic worker organising on the 22nd of July this year, it will also mark the launch of a new campaign to resolve the situation of women in this kind of situation. So this is a very brief overview of the achievements and challenges of organising domestic workers in the last 30 years. I want to then ask, what does this tell us in terms of integration, multiculturalism, and human rights? I think people who work in private households challenge ideas of integration. After all, we could say they're highly integrated. They work in the heart of Europe. They work in families. There's often complaints that unintegrated migrants keep themselves to themselves, that they don't engage with citizens. But migrant domestic workers engage with different generations in their day-to-day life as they look after the elderly, pick up children from school, prepare food, clean houses, and so on. In many cases, they facilitate the employment of parents, enabling mothers in particular to go out to work. And they paper over the cracks in welfare states, which increasingly don't accommodate unpredictable, irregular working hours, those kinds of hours which now in our economies are becoming increasingly normal. But despite this, migrant domestic workers are often isolated and lonely. Maybe their situation actually shows us how unintegrated our own lives are, how separated the private from the public, how the home is imagined as a space of relaxation and consumption, and the work involved in maintaining it is gendered and invisible and is always under the shadow of the productive economy. And considering the situation of migrant domestic workers also tells us a lot about employers. A few years ago, I conducted surveys with employers of migrant domestic workers in London and Barcelona. I found that the majority of employers said they would not consider employing a man to look after their children. They would perhaps employ a man to look after an elderly relative, but only certain nationalities, most definitely not, for example, black Africans. Indeed, when recruiting for private households, employers are overtly racist in ways I suspect they never would be if they were employing for a job outside the home. They deploy stereotypes about certain nationalities being docile or dirty or lazy with an easy racism that in other contexts would be unacceptable. So again, it is employing families who are revealed as clinging on to old-fashioned ideas of race and gender. Furthermore, while we are accustomed to thinking of household violence as principally perpetrated by men, when it comes to migrant domestic workers, it is often the female employer who is the perpetrator of physical violence. The woman harms the worker, and then sometimes the husband comes and apologizes. And I have to say, it's something that I find very annoying when I'm working with domestic workers, hearing domestic workers basically complain about the woman and then say that the man is really, really nice. And because I don't want to take the position that, you know, so there's lots of men get really excited about this. They, oh, see, it just goes to show that men, women are just as bad as men. I think that actually what you see is that it's the situation of domestic workers and the violence of female employers is particularly noticeable in countries where women's status and the status of domestic labour is particularly low. We have to remember too that it's the female employer and not the male employer who has to negotiate often a very difficult relationship with the domestic worker, distinguishing their different roles and often ending up competing, for example, for the affections of the children. And actually also when domestic workers are looking after older people, getting worried about the will and what's going to happen to the money if the domestic worker seems to be getting a bit too close to the elderly employer. That's when the man tends to step in. So this is not to make excuses for violent and abusive employers, but to say we have to recognise that abuses can be perpetrated by women, but it does not mean that they are independent of patriarchal relations. But it is with respect to human rights that I think the story gets even more complicated. As I said earlier, in the example of the visa in the UK, domestic workers were granted the right to change employer, but not on the basis of their work. It was only in cases of abuse. So if we think about it, this kind of only in the case of abuse is not really very typical. I can leave my employing university, it's not only if the vice chancellor abuses me that I have the right to change my employer. So why is this caveat necessary with domestic workers? In fact, all over the world, most so-called low-skilled migrant workers, domestic workers or not, are not able to change employer. So while there's considerable criticism from Europe of the Gulf state kafala system, in practice, states that permit the legal entry of low-wage migrants to work often require them to work for a specific employer. This gives a tremendous amount of power to the employer, and in fact, goes to the heart of the nature of contract and free labour. So if domestic workers are imagined as low-skilled, which means that if they were being treated like any other low-skilled migrant worker, actually, you wouldn't be able to get the right to change employer. So the reason that we have this caveat, you can change employer in the case of abuse, meant that it was possible for domestic workers to change employers and to be recognised as workers without incorporating them into the normal rules governing low-skilled migrant workers. So in this way, it was possible to ring-fence domestic work as a special case and not risk it setting a precedent. So in a way, it's being treated not like a typical job. So when the new visa was brought in 2012, government ministers did not dispute that employment in private households could be abusive. But they said, I thought I had the quote, but anyway, they said, so this is from the government, we do not necessarily believe that a right to change employer, whatever the reason, is the only way to provide protection. And in fact, the Home Office argued that the main protection for migrant domestic workers was going to be that they weren't going to be allowed to come in. So I quote, "The biggest protection for these workers will be delivered by limiting access to the UK." So they said, people who were abused under the new six-month time visa would have recourse to protections via anti-trafficking measures and a promised modern slavery bill. So their human rights would be protected, even though their rights as workers were going to be curtailed, and this would happen through anti-trafficking protections. They were to be protected, their human rights were to be protected, but not their workers' rights. So 2012, when this new law was brought in, there had been more than a decade of campaigning against trafficking by a wide range of actors. All sorts of people found common cause in stamping out trafficking. And the UK government was an early signatory to the 2001 Protocol on Trafficking in Persons. It was the end of the Cold War. The political refugee had changed and become the bogus asylum seeker, whose rights were much more contested. The extension of protection of human rights to refugees was no longer straightforwardly the hallmark of liberal democracies, freedom, and respect for the rights of non-citizens. So it was here that at this moment the victim of trafficking materialises. Concerted efforts by campaigners and activists at national and global level shifted the ground towards an understanding of trafficking as including trafficking for the purposes of forced labour, and this contributed in turn to the rise of the language of modern slavery, and meant that labour rights and migrants' rights groups began to find common cause with states in denouncing exploitation and abuse of migrants as victims of trafficking or modern-day slavery. The victims of so-called domestic slavery drew from the same group of poorer women who are often migrants. Like prostitution, paid domestic work is caught between the public and the private, and whether commodification is the source of the problem or offers the solution is subject to considerable debate. However, while everyone can agree that trafficking and modern slavery is wrong, what's actually meant by those terms and the source of the problem is subject to considerable disagreement. So what we see with the domestic worker visa is that the consensus about the evils of slavery and trafficking can hide very different analyses of the role of immigration controls in situations of modern slavery. So what's happening now is that domestic workers are arguing immigration controls are contributing to constructing vulnerability by tying workers to employers. In contrast, the Home Office proposed to stop abuse by domestic workers by border checks. So the Home Office is saying we can protect workers through checking at borders and seeing whether or not they are being trafficked. We're going to intervene at the borders. The domestic workers are saying, we need a visa that will give us the right to change employer, then you won't have to intervene with your anti-trafficking protections because we will be able to leave the employer ourselves. So this position goes beyond the claim that sponsorship arrangements enforced by immigration controls against low-skilled workers are compatible with free labour, and they present immigration controls and enforcement as a means of protecting migrants from slavery, and border controls, borders as points of intervention where individual abusers can be identified and brought to justice. In its presentation of immigration enforcement as a process that is supportive of migrant rights, the UK government emphasises the problem of barbaric foreign employers as key to vulnerability. Home Secretary, now our Prime Minister, and apparently leading us into the Brexit negotiations if she wins the next election, fingers crossed, said that she was concerned that the overseas domestic worker route, so this was the visa that allowed people to change employers, can result in the import of abusive employer-employee relationships to the UK. So basically, what she's saying is there are these foreigners who are bringing in their foreign ways and who don't know how to treat their domestic servants properly. That's the root of the problem. That's her position. However, when it comes to British workers and the fact that, British employers, and the fact that British employers also don't recognise domestic workers' rights, we're far more understanding of why that might be. So the UK government, along with Saudi Arabia, was one of the very few that refused to sign the ILO Convention on the Protection of Domestic Workers' Rights. And the reason that they refused to sign it, we can see here. We do not consider it appropriate or practical to extend criminal health and safety legislation, including inspections, to cover private households employing domestic workers. It would be difficult to hold elderly individuals who employ carers to the same standards as large companies. So basically, when it comes to foreign employers, they're barbarians who are importing slaves. When it comes to British employers, look, we've got to feel sorry for them because they're old people and it's all very, very complicated. So, you know, let's give them a break. So this reveals another problem with the modern with the slavery narrative, which is that it relies for its political purchase on very extreme cases. So the elderly individuals that the previous slide was talking about, just not able to cope with bureaucracy of labour rights. And it's true, the government can realistically say, both for foreign employers and British employers, most cases of abuse are not cases of rape. They're not the kind of case that the example that I gave you, not physical violence, much more mundane abuses and indignities, not being given a bed, working excessive hours, not having your pension paid, not being paid the minimum wage. So not what one might imagine as being modern slavery, but still not respecting workers' rights. So the problem is, of course, that then this all sounds quite mundane, and well, why are you complaining about that when you're, you know, when there are women who are being abused and raped and so on? So it sets the bar actually much lower. So these limitations were exposed in debates around the modern slavery bill. So the there was an amendment that proposed to include in the bill the reinstatement of the right of migrant domestic workers to change employers as a means to protect them from slavery. And this was the government's response. So basically, what this means, in a nutshell, you can read it on the screen, is that people who are working for abusive employers are only encouraging abuse when they leave the employers. Really, what they need to do is trust the authorities and go to immigration and report their problems. So domestic workers who are abused were given one of two options. Either they come forward to the police or they stay with violent abusers. It puts the onus on the workers to present themselves to the authorities, but the authorities have already said they must remain with their employers. In this version of fighting slavery, recognising workers' rights is, bizarrely, not an anti-slavery measure. The idea that people must be saved from slave traders by border controls and enforcement has become widespread. In 2015, the response of many European governments to large numbers of people attempting to cross the Mediterranean in rickety boats was to claim that these people, many of whom had fled violence and civil war in Syria, Afghanistan, and Iraq, were victims of latter-day slave merchants. At one stage, some EU governments were even proposing to use force and bomb boats to prevent them from leaving Libya, claiming thereby to be saving people from the slave trade, but in practice, confining them to Libya, which, as we know, is riven by warring factions, corruption, violence, and racist hostility. It's clear from these responses that one problem with using immigration controls and border enforcement as a point of intervention is the same body that is charged with protecting vulnerable migrants from slavery and trafficking is also responsible for the prevention of entry and illegalization, and deporting or imprisoning those found to be in breach of immigration controls. The focus on identifying victims and villains ignores the role of the state in creating vulnerability and in handing over power to employers. In the case of domestic workers, the removal of a visa that gave rights to migrants as independent workers and the promise to help those most egregious cases, while at the same time enforcing removals against people who have left abusive employers, reveals a flaw at the heart of the system. Immigration is a deeply political issue. The state is a protector of human rights, but there is ample empirical evidence that certain groups of migrants fear state intrusion and offers of protection because of their immigration status. To suggest that further immigration controls and anti-trafficking policing is as a solution is missing the point, and greater attention to the rights of workers independent of their immigration status, and more particularly the separation of workers' rights from immigration enforcement mechanisms, might in a way be a more effective means of preventing human rights than anti-trafficking laws. But it also raises an even bigger question. In a grossly unequal world, how possible is it for immigration controls to be compatible with justice? Thank you.